This is Concept E classes, and today we'll study Chapter 8 of Social and Political Life 3, Class 8 NCERT, Confronting Marginalization. So in the last chapter, we understood what was marginalization. In this chapter, we'll see how this marginalized group confronted or faced or challenged this marginalization. So in this video, first we'll see how this marginalized group invoked the fundamental rights, and we'll see some of the laws for this marginalized group. Then we'll see some of the policies and schemes that the Constitution took in order to protect the rights of the Dalits and Adivasis. And we'll see the Adivasi demands and the 1989 Act. In the previous chapters, we saw how this marginalized group experienced inequality and discrimination. And even though they were powerless, they fought, they protested and struggled against these dominated group, and they have attempted to overcome their situation by adopting a range of strategies. Now, religious solace means they found comfort in religion. Some used armed struggle, they used weapons for struggling. There was self-improvement, education, economic afflict. These were some of the ways for improving their conditions. And in all these cases, the choice of the struggle has depended on the circumstances that this marginalized group find themselves in. And many marginalized groups like the Adivasis, the Dalits, the Muslims, the women, they all argued that being in a democratic country, they possess equal rights and that they must be respected. And many among them even looked up to the Constitution to address their concerns. So in this chapter, we'll see why the Constitution of India was invoked in the course of the struggles, then how these rights, fundamental rights, were translated into laws to protect groups from exploitation. And we'll see the government's effort to formulate the policies to promote the access of these groups to develop. So first, let's see how the marginalized group invoked the fundamental rights. Invoking means like appealing or calling on the fundamental rights. Now, we have already studied in chapter 1 how the Constitution laid down certain principles that make our society democratic. And these are all defined through the list of fundamental rights. And these fundamental rights are available to all Indians equally. So the marginalized, they have drawn on these rights in two ways. Firstly, they insisted on their fundamental rights, and they have forced the government to recognize the injustice done to them. They forced the government to understand what they were facing. Secondly, they have insisted that the government enforced these laws. In some instances, the struggle of this marginalized have influenced the government to frame new laws in keeping with the spirit of fundamental rights. So let's understand some sections of the Constitution that help this marginalized groups. One such section is Article 17 of the Constitution. It stated that untouchability has been abolished. That means no one can prevent the Dalits from educating themselves, entering the temples, using public facilities, etc. It also stated that it is wrong to practice untouchability, and this practice will not be tolerated by the democratic government. In fact, untouchability is a punishable crime now. Now, the term Dalit that we used here means broken, and it is used deliberately or purposefully and actively by the groups to highlight the centuries of discrimination they have experienced within the caste system. Now, there are other sections in the Constitution other than this Article 17 which help to strengthen the argument against untouchability. That is the Article 15 of the Constitution. It states that no citizen of India can be discriminated against on the basis of their religion, their race, their caste, sex, or place of birth. And this has been used by Dalits to seek equality where it has been denied to them. So the Dalits, they can invoke these fundamental rights when they feel that the majority community or even the government has treated them badly. And these Dalits have been successful even in drawing the government's attention to the constitution laws so that they could get justice. So just like how the Dalits use the Article 17 and Article 15, other minority groups have also drawn on the fundamental rights section of our constitution, like the right to freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights. For instance, the minority religious groups like the Muslims and Parsis, they have the right to be the guardians of the content of their culture as well as the right to make decisions on how best this content is to be preserved. Thus, the Constitution, it tries to ensure cultural justice to such groups by granting different forms of cultural rights. The Constitution does this because they want the culture of this group not to be wiped out by the majority community. Now let's understand the laws for the marginalized. Now, even though the government make laws to protect the citizens, it is not only the way in which it takes action. There are specific laws and policies for the marginalized in our country, and the government then makes an effort to promote such policies in order to give opportunities to these specific groups. Now, these policies and schemes, they emerge through other means like setting up a committee or undertaking a survey, etc. In the last chapter, we saw how a high-level committee was set up when the Muslim groups were marginalized. So let's see how the government promotes social justice to these marginalized groups like the Dalits and Adivasis. In order to implement the constitution, both the state as well as the central government create specific schemes for the implementation in tribal areas or in areas that have high Dalit population. For example, the government provides free hostel facilities to the students of the Dalit and Adivasi communities so they can have this educational facilities even though it might not be available in their local areas. Now, in addition to this, the government also operates through laws to ensure that concrete steps are taken to end this inequality. One such law or policy is the reservation policy. The law states that it reserves seats in the education and the government employment bases. These peoples have been denied opportunities to learn and to work. And in order to develop the new skills and vocations, the democratic government need to step in and assess these sections. Now let's see how this reservation policy works. The central as well as the state government, they have their own list of scheduled caste or Dalits, scheduled tribes, backward and most backward caste. Students applying to educational institutions or for the post in government, they are asked to produce a proof of their caste or tribe status in the form of the caste or tribe certificates. And now if a particular Dalit caste or certain tribe is on the government list, then a candidate from that caste can avail the benefit of reservation. Now, for the admissions to colleges, especially to institutes of professional education such as medical colleges, engineering colleges, the government define a set of cutoff marks. So this is an example of the cutoff marks on UPSC examination, and we can see the cutoff marks here. See, for the SC, ST, how the difference is there. And this means that not all the Dalit and tribal candidates can qualify for admission, but only those who have secured marks above the cutoff point can have this reservations. The government also offers special scholarships for this students so that they can study in future without any hindrance. Now let's see protecting the rights of Dalits and the Adivasi. Now, other than the policies, our country also have specific laws that guard against discrimination and exploitation of marginalized communities. One such law was the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe Prevention of Atrocity Acts 1989. So let's understand more about this Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocity Acts of 1989. Now, this act protected the Scheduled Caste and Scheduled Tribe against the domination and violence of other powerful castes. This act was framed in 1989 in response to the demands made by the Dalit. They started making demands from the government to seriously consider the ill treatments and the harassment faced by them. And this continued for a long time, this harassment. However, it took a violent form in the late 1970 and 1980. So let's see what happened. Now, during the 1970 and 1980, in parts of southern India, some Dalit groups started asserting their rights. What did they do? They refused to perform their so-called duties and insisted on being treated equally. They refuse to follow the practices located in the humiliation and exploitation of Dalits. That is, they refuse to do their so-called duties. So these powerful castes, they started unleashing violences against them. Now, the constitution already have prohibited untouchability, but this untouchability was practiced in the country in a hidden manner. So the Dalit groups, they demanded new laws that would list the various sorts of violence against the Dalits and prescribe the most severe punishment for those who indulge in them. That is, the Dalit groups, they demanded new laws from the government against these violences and asked to give severe punishment for those people who do these discrimination. Likewise, throughout 1970 and 1980, the Adivasi groups successfully organized themselves and demanded equal rights for their land and resources to be returned to them. We saw how the Adivasi groups were driven out from the forest and how they had a very tough livelihood. So they demanded equal rights for the land and resources to be returned. They too had to face the anger of powerful social groups and were subject to a great deal of violence. That is why this act, what was the name of the act? The Scheduled Caste and the Scheduled Tribe Prevention of Atrocity Act. It contained a very long list of crimes, some of which are very too horrible even to think. And this act, it does not only describe the terrible crimes, but it also let the people to know what dreadful deeds the human beings are capable of. So this act distinguishes several levels of crime. Firstly, it lists the modes of humiliation that are both physically horrible for the victims and morally reprehensible. Morally reprehensible means it is an act that violates the norm of decency or dignity of a human being. And this act seeks to punish those who force a member of a scheduled caste or scheduled tribe to drink or eat any inedible or obnoxious, like means unpleasant substance with great odor and all, with bad smell and all. If they force a member of the scheduled caste or tribe to eat, they will be punished. The act also punish those who forcibly removes clothes from a person of a member of a scheduled caste or scheduled tribe, or parades him or her naked or with a painted face or body, or commits any similar act which is an insult to the human dignity. Now, secondly, this act lists actions that disposes the Dalits and Adivasis for their meagre resources. Meagre resources means the resources, the deficient resources, or which force them into performing slave labour. Thus, this act sets out to punish anyone who wrongfully occupies or cultivates any land owned by or allotted to a member of a scheduled caste or scheduled tribe, or gets a land allotted to him transferred. Now, at another level, this act recognizes that crimes against the Dalit and tribal women are of a specific kind, and therefore seeks to penalize anyone who assaults or uses force on any woman belonging to the scheduled caste or scheduled tribe with an intent to dishonor her. So let's take an instance of this Dalit community where they suffered humiliation and how the government helped them to face this calamity. So let's understand this through the scourge of manual scavenging. The scourge means the torture of manual scavenging. Now, the term manual scavenging refers to the practice of removing human and animal waste or excreta using brooms, tin plates and baskets from dry latrines and carrying it on the head to the disposal grounds some distance away. And a manual scavenger is a person who does this job. He carries this filth. Now, this job is mainly done by Dalit women and young girls. Now, according to Andhra Pradesh based Safai Karamchari Andolan, there are about 1 lakh persons from the Dalit communities who continue to be employed in this job in this country and work in 26 lakh private and community dry latrine managed by the municipalities. The manual scavengers are often exposed to subhuman conditions for work and they face serious health hazards. Like, they are constantly exposed to infections that affects their eyes, their skin, the respiratory and the gastrointestinal system. They even get very low wages for the work they perform. The man who scavengers in different parts of the country, like the Vangis in Gujarat, the Pakis in Andhra Pradesh, the Sikilas in Tamil Nadu, they are considered to be untouchable. And they often live in separate settlements on the outskirts of the village, and they are denied to the access to temple, public water facilities, etc. So in 1993, the government passed the Employment of Manmal Scavengers and the Construction of Dry Latrine Prohibition Act. This law, it prohibited the employment of manual scavengers as well as the construction of dry latrines. Now in 2003, the Safai Karamchari Andolan and 13 other organizations and individuals, including 7 scavengers, filed a PIL in the Supreme Court. So the petitioners, they complained that the manual scavenging still existed, and this continued in the government undertaking like the railways. And the petitioners, they sought enforcement of their fundamental rights. So the court, they observed that the number of manmal scavengers in India had increased since 1993 law, and it directed every department or ministry of the union government and state government to verify the facts within 6 months. Now if manual scavenging was found to exist, then the government department had to actively take up a time-bound program for their liberation and rehabilitation. And the prohibition of employment as manual scavengers and the Rehabilitation Act, it came into force on 6th December 2013. So now let's see the Adivasi demands and the 1989 Act. Now the 1989 Act was important for the Adivasi activists, as they refer to it to defend their rights to occupy the land that was traditionally theirs. In the previous chapters, we saw how the Adivasis were driven out from their lands and they were forcibly displaced. So the activists have asked that those who have forcibly encroached upon tribal lands should be punished under this law. They have pointed to the fact that this act merely confirms what the constitution has promised to the tribals. The constitution has promised the tribals that the land belonging to the tribal people cannot be sold or brought by non-tribal people. And in cases where this has happened, the constitution guarantees the right of the tribal people to repossess these lands. Now an Adivasi activist named C.K. Janu, she has pointed out that one of the violators of this constitutional rights which were guaranteed to the tribal people were the state governments of India. That is, she pointed out that it is a state government from different regions that took away the tribal lands. Because she said that it was they who allowed non-tribal encroachers in the form of timber merchants, paper mills, etc. to exploit the tribal land, and they forcibly evict the tribal people from their traditional forest in the process of declaring forest as their reserve or as sanctuaries. She also noted that in cases where the tribals have already been evicted and cannot go back to the lands, they should be compensated. This is the government must draw up plans and policies for them to live and work elsewhere. That is, the government should introduce certain policies and residential areas and occupations so that these people could live. So what was the conclusion of this chapter? We saw that the existence of a right or law or even a policy on a paper doesn't mean that it exists in reality. The people have to constantly work on or make efforts to translate these into the principles that guide the actions of their fellow citizens or even their leaders. And the desire of equality, dignity and respect is not new. We have seen in history how all they have fought for this. Similarly, even in a democratic country, similar processes of struggle, writing, negotiation and organizing need to continue. So that's all for this chapter. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.